قل لو كان
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا، ثم أما بعد. Welcome, this is the final session inshallah in the series بإذن الله عز وجل before we take a break for the month of Ramadan. And our discussion is the hereafter events of the day of judgment. If you remember from last time, the last thing we discussed together was part of the hisab, the questioning. What are the type of questions people they're going to be asked on judgment day? And we mentioned a lot of these questions. And if I want to see if you guys still remember some of these questions people will be asked about on judgment day. What is the first question? What is the first question in regard to the relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What will be that first question about what? Salah, their prayers, if they fulfill their prayers. What about, what is the first question that is going to be asked about in regard to the relationship with human beings and with the people? What would it be? Blood. And what does that exactly mean? It means if they have ever hurt someone, if they hurt somebody, if they attacked someone, if they assaulted anybody, if they caused any harm, any physical harm or damage or abuse to anybody. This will be the first question people are going to be asked about on judgment day in regard to the rights of the people. Even they're going to be questioned and asked about the animals, if they even taking care of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's so many questions, and we mentioned different types of questioning. Finally, we move on right now, inshallah ta'ala, to what happened next. So if you remember, people will stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala individually, and each one of them will be asked few questions. And after they're asked these few questions, then they're going to be moved to wait to receive the results. Just like when you go on testing, right? When you go for an exam, you've already been given the opportunity, you've already been given the resources and the information and everything and so on. Then you come to the test, and after the test is over, there's a review. So, okay, you've done this, you've done that, that's what you've done. So it's kind of like reviewing what you've done. People now start freaking out. They want to know exactly if they did well or bad, and if bad, how bad, and if well, how good they've done in their lives. This is now the time when the when books are going to be distributed among the people. It's just like saying, giving the people their report cards. This is just like saying, giving the people the report cards. When you get the report card, does that mean, do you know when you get your report card, do you know that the prize that you're getting? Not yet. But you know one thing. What is it? That you passed. You know that you passed. And when they say that you passed, that means that you're successful. Now, how much you're going to be rewarded, what's the final result of it, that's coming later, inshallah ta'ala. So the first thing, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judges between the people now, they are going to start receiving their books. There are two categories of people, and they're basically, the end result will be two ways. Number one, whether they receive it in their right hand. Number two, receiving it in the left hand. Some people will receive it in their right hand, and others will receive it in the left hand, and that's indication to be from the people of the right hand, meaning from the people of paradise. And if they say the left hand, that will be the people of the fire of the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described these signs in many ways. One of the surah, Surah Al-Haqqa, and I recited the ayat in Salat Al-Maghrib already. قال الله تعالى فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ. Then, as for he who is given his record in his right hand, فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا. He will be judged with an easy account. Which means, he is going to be reminded with what he has done. She's going to be reminded what she has done. And it's going to be an easy questioning. It's not going to be that severe questioning. وَيَنْقَلِبُ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ مَسْرُورًا, and return to his people in happiness. So the account, that question is going to be simple and easy, and then they move on very happy. So basically, they're very happy. But how happy? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala details that in a different surah, Surah Al-Haqqa, the previous one was Surah Al-Inshiqaq. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ فَيَقُولُ هَاءُ مُقْرَأُ كِتَابِيًا. So as for he who is given his record in his right hand, he will say, here, read my record. And I mentioned that, if you remember in the khutbah, one time, I remember when we were very, very young in school, in elementary, whenever you used to finish an assignment, our teacher used to have a nice, beautiful seal and stamp that says, excellent, and some stars and some beautiful stuff. So what we used to do, he used to stamp on that on your book or your notebook, and he will ask you to walk around in the classroom showing the other kids what you've done. as a source of encouragement, perhaps, to encourage others, and also to make you feel proud of your achievement. I remember as children how proud we used to feel when we used to walk around the classroom to show everybody what we have achieved. And some kids would be so mean that they would pretend that they're not paying attention to you. And they were kind of like pretending they're doing their assignment. So you push them and you alert them. You start pushing, look, hey, look what I've done. You show them the book exactly. Say, this is what I've done. So that you want to feel proud and you want to show them what you've done. SubhanAllah, this is in the dunya. This is just in the dunya, and we are children at that time. You're just so happy that we have a stamp and a seal that says excellent. Imagine when this is the akhirah and the prize over here is al-jannah, that is paradise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so that when they're given the records in the right hand, they start running around asking people and telling them, look, read what I've done over here. And they would say, inni dhanantu anni mulaqin hisabiya. Indeed, I was certain that I would be meeting my account. I knew it, that I'm going to be meeting my Lord. I'm going to be set to the account. فَهُوَ فِي عِيشَةٍ رَاضِيَةٍ. So he will be in a pleasant life. Allah subhanahu did not give too many details later about that pleasant life, but it is the life, of course, of Jannat al-Firdaus. This is the first category. The second category, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described them in two ways. Number one, that they will receive their books in their left hand. And number two, that they will receive their books behind their backs. Here's the ayah here in Surah Al-Inshiqaq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوتِيَ كِتَابَهُ وَرَاءَ ظَهْرِهِ فَسَوْفَ يَدْعُو ثُبُورًا وَيَصْلَى سَعِيرًا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فِي أَهْلِهِ مَسْرُورًا. But as for he who is given his record behind his back, he will cry out of destruction, his frustration right now, and enter to burn in blaze in Jahannam. Indeed, he had once been among his people in happiness, which means he took his happiness and he rejoiced, he took the time of happiness in this temporary life when the eternal happiness was yet to come. So he wasted his opportunity enjoying that temporary pleasure when he was supposed to enjoy, or at least work so hard on gaining the pleasure, the eternal pleasure in the Akhirah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described them again by saying they will get their books in their left hands. وَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِشِمَالِهِ فَيَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أُوتَ كِتَابِيَ وَلَمْ أَدْرِ مَا حِسَابِيَ يَا لَيْتَهَا كَانَتْ الْقَاضِيَةَ. But as for he who is given his record in his left hand, he will say, oh, I wish I had not been given my record and had not known what is my account. I wish my death had been the decisive one and was over with it. So now, here's the two things. People are given their books in their left hand, and others are given their books and behind their backs. How can we reconcile between these two scenarios of it? What does that exactly mean? Can you guess? How would it look like? But why would they receive it behind their backs anyway? Why? So they try to cheat, right? They want to cheat. So when they want to cheat, what do they usually do? They want to hide their hands behind their backs, so at least if my book flies towards me, eventually I would catch it in my right hand. But who can cheat on that day? No one. You can't cheat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam describing how these books are going to be distributed. How they're going to be distributed. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that these books will be flying. Tatir, tatayur as-suhuf, which means these books will be flying. I'm sure perhaps maybe subhanAllah, Allah musta'an, even Hollywood is actually trying to imitate some of the images of the Akhirah, by the way, in whatever they try to do. So eventually when they have flying books coming towards the people, and people will be spreading their arms trying to catch these books. So as for the believer, of course, everybody at that moment, you can tell now that the thrill and the anxiety at the same time. Because after you had the account with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most people, they feel that they're doomed, right? Even the good ones, they feel that they're doomed because they haven't done good enough. So they might feel that they're going to fail at this moment. So as they spread their arms wide, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless the believers to receive their books in the right hand. Imagine the moment of joy when someone on that day, knowing that what is coming next is eternal. It's not temporary, and it's nothing like you've ever seen or heard of before. Imagine when they get their books in the right hands. What does that exactly, what does it mean to them? That you won. You passed. You're going to be happy. That means you are going to be happy. And when other people, they're now just, you know, kind of hoping and wishing that they get it in the right hand, and some of them, they try to hide their hands behind their back, but the book still would fly and would land into their left hand. Can you now imagine the feeling of frustration, the feeling of destruction that they have right now emotionally, mentally, about their future, knowing that the future is still worse? Whatever they've gone through that they thought that was terrible already, it's nothing compared to what is coming next, and that thing is going to be eternal. So people, they will receive their books. And that sight, I want you to imagine right now, the graduates. Now this is the season of graduation, right? We're in May, and now the season of graduation. People are going out, mashallah, wearing dressing their nice, you know, suits and clothes and so on. And so you see that those who are hopeful to have, let's say, their graduation to be the best, they eventually, what they do, they go, you know, very happy and rejoicing eventually. And then when they receive their certificates and their awards, it will be the best moment for them. And those who know that they haven't done very well, they feel kind of a little bit, you know, down at that time. Even those who have done good, but they just passed, barely. They're happy, but not as happy as the other people, subhanAllah. Here's the same thing. That scenario is the exact same thing. People, they have their books. You can now imagine the beauty of the people who receive their hands, their books in the right hand. They're running all over the place, showing each other. What did you get? Let me see, what did you have? And everybody's trying to show each other right now, look what I've done. I knew it. And everybody's declaring their success right now at that moment. And the others who receive their books in their left hand, what are they doing? They're grieving right now. They're turning around grieving. They want to be left out, left alone. They're trying to find any way to escape this situation, but there is no escape whatsoever. Everybody now, after they receive their books, things cool a little bit down. What comes next? The next situation, the next station right now, is to check between the believers right now, to check between them, and even the number, even those who have actually received their books on the left hand, اقتصاص المظالم بين الخلق, settling the dues. This is the settlement stage right now. Settlement for what? The settlement for what? The settlement for everything that you've done in this world. And people on the Day of Judgment, they're not going to pay back with money, with gold, with silver. No, they're going to be paying back with hasanat and sayyi'at, with good deeds and bad deeds, with merits and sayyi'at. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned this hadith that on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يحكم بين العباد, He will judge between the creation, al-jinn wal-ins, and even the animals. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said that there will, people will be settling, يَقْتَصُّ بَعْضُهُمْ مِنْ بَعْضٍ. They start now going into that settlement. They settle the due, basically they're clearing the accounts among themselves right now. So he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will settle the situation, Allah azza wa jal will settle the situation even between animals, حَتَّى يُقَادُ لِلشَّاتِ الْجَلْحَاءِ مِنَ الشَّاتِ الْقَرْنَاءِ. Means that hornless, the hornless will take revenge from the horned one that once, you know, hit it and injured it. So even among the animals, that means it's a complete show of justice. Even between the animals, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge between them. Then there is the turn comes after that between the human beings. And how is this going to be? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned in another hadith that everybody will be judged and everybody is going to be, you know, kind of receiving that settlement with each other. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man kanat lahu madlama, if you ever wronged anybody, fi irdihi, fi malihi, whether you cursed him, cussed him, took this money, her money, or whatever, any kind of wrongdoing against a human being, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, falyatahallal minhu al-yawm, let this person seek forgiveness from the other party this day, meaning this world. Why? Because that day there will be no dinar wala dirham. On that day, there will be no payments of money, no payments of gold or silver, nothing except for the deeds. وَإِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ, it's only through the hasanat, فَإِنْ كَانَ لَهُ عَمَلٌ صَالِحٌ أُخِذَ مِنْ. If this person left good deeds, will be taken away from him and given to the other party. Until their hasanat is completely consumed. And if they are left with nothing, then what happens? They're going to take from their sayyi'at, will be thrown on his. In another narration, the Prophet ﷺ gave a little bit more vivid and subhanAllah, more vivid and practical example over here. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَتَدْرُونَ مَا الْمُفْلِسِ, do you know who is the bankrupt? قَالُوا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ الْمُفْلِسُ فِينا مَنْ لَا دِرْهَمَ لَهُ وَلَا دِينَارِ, is the one who has no dollar, no gold, no silver. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no, this is not the real muflis. Which means it is true, financially speaking, that's the bankrupt. But with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, true bankruptcy, it's much more than that. He said, innahu dhalika rajul, this is the man who comes on the day of judgment, man or woman, who comes on the day of judgment, bi'a'mal kajibal tihama, with good deeds, the size of the mountains of Tihama. If you've ever been to Hajj or Umrah, the mountains of Tihama stretches for south from Mecca all the way down to Yemen. These are huge mountains. You're talking about huge, huge mountains. He said, this person will come on the day of judgment with good deeds, the size of the mountains of Tihama. However, جَاءَ وَقَدْ شَتَمَ هَذَا وَضَرَبَ هَذَا وَأَكَلَ مَالَ هَذَا. So this person, he cursed this man. And he took the money of this person. And he hurt that person. So it's only things that we consider maybe little things. Like cursing, cussing, speaking bad, backbiting, you know, lying at this person and so on. Things that we to be considered insignificant. But with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're all significant matters. So then the Prophet says, فَيَأْخُذُ هَذَا مِنْ حَسَنَاتِ وَهَذَا مِنْ حَسَنَاتِ. Each will be taken from his hasanat now. That's how the settlement is going to be. And then eventually, if the hasanat is consumed, they will be taken from their sayyat, and they will be thrown into on his. Until, of course, this person, may Allah protect us all, if this is the case, he will be doomed. So this person might have had his book in the right hand, meaning that he passed. But that doesn't mean it's going to be passed, meaning immediately to Al-Jannah. Maybe it's basically you're going to have to stay a little bit to take extra classes. Like you didn't pass first, you know, first exam. You're going to have to take a makeup exam right now. In that fashion. So this is when the time comes for the people to start taking that settlement. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned that the people will be coming to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala holding each other. People will be holding each other. Ya Rab, I remember this person, he owes me $100. He never paid it back. Ya Rabbi, this person, he promised me that day to do so and so, and he never fulfilled, and because of this, I had to deal with so and so. So people just start basically trying, coming to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, grabbing each other. So, which means perhaps, wallahu ta'ala alam, almost each and every one of us, may Allah protect us all from the situation, jama'ah. But almost every individual is going to have to deal with these two situations. Taking hasanat from others, and perhaps maybe from his hasanat will be taken away from him. Instantly. As you take your hasanat from this person, guess what happens? Someone says, yeah, but you owe me that much money. So they take from you. And keeps going like this until the settlement is completely over. Now ask yourself the question. How many people you know in your life? How many people that you know? How many people you deal with? How many people you interact with on a regular basis? Their interpersonal relationship that you have with them. With how many people you're dealing with money with them? How many people you have all these dues basically that and rights that you have to fulfill, whether they're your parents, your children, your spouse, your friends, your co-workers, people that entrusted you with something. How many are these people? As many people as you're dealing with in life, you need to expect that you're going to have to kind of deal with these people in that fashion. SubhanAllah, even as you guys sitting together socializing and you start talking about somebody, thinking that it's nothing significant, but backbiting is a very dangerous thing. Even that might cause you to lose your hasanat and earn more sayyat. May Allah protect us from that. So then after everything is settled right now, after everything is settled, as we mentioned earlier, the settlement starts with the blood and other things, of course, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show the people now al-baha'im, the animals. And the animals, they start settling with each other, of course. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals with the animals completely, bringing them justice, in a way that is meaningful to them, of course, in a way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how it would look like. Finally, Allah says to these animals, kunu turaba, then be dust. And they will all become dust. Because they're not going to go into al-jannah. That's it. There's no jannah for them. They were never mukallafin. They were never accountable to do much. Allah created them for the benefit of human beings and the jinn. So they were done with their role in life. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, be dust, and they will be dust. That's when a disbeliever would look and would say, I wish I can be dust. Which means, I wish I were dust, that this person at that time, he would wish he had been an animal in this dunya to end up like the animals, just to turn into dust. Then what happens? Now everybody, finally, after the settlement is over, people back now, they become more anxious. You know, when they received their book in the right hand, first of all, they were very happy, excited, and they're rejoicing and so on. But then they were the settlement phase. Okay, alhamdulillah, you have all these beautiful things that you've done in your life, but listen, you hurt me. You owe me that. You owe me this, you owe me that. So they start doing the settlement. And now people, they go back into their books, not knowing how much my book is going to weigh right now. Okay, I want to know how much the book is going to weigh. And that's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنَضَعُ الْمَوَازِينَ الْقِسْطَ لِيَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ فَلَا تُظْلَمُ نَفْسٌ شَيْئًا وَإِنْ كَانَ مِثْقَالَ حَبَّةٍ مِّنْ خَرْدَلٍ أَتَيْنَا بِهَا وَكَفَى بِنَا حَاسِبِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, and we place the scales of justice for the day of resurrection. So no soul will be treated unjustly at all. And if there is even the way of a mustard seed, we will bring it forth. Means if you owe, that much will bring it for you. And if you ask, if we owe you that much, we're going to bring it. So the good and the bad, the positive and the negative, you're going to all see that. وَكَفَى بِنَا حَاسِبِينَ. Unsufficient are we as accountant. Which means if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who's the accountant, can you expect anything to go waste? Not at all. The major, the minor, going to be found in that book. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give the command to set the scales. To set the scales. And he said subhanahu wa ta'ala in other ayat, قَالَ subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَمَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَهُوَ فِي عِشَةِ الرَّاضِيَةِ. And for the person whose mawazin, his scales are heavy, he will have a happy life, a life of happiness. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used mawazin, which means scales. The ulama, they argue about scales. What are they exactly? In the Arabic language, a scale is known as al-mizan, or mizan. So mizan means a scale. What kind of scale is that? Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, ulama of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, they believe that the scale is an actual physical creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will create that scale. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create that scale. How does it look like in details? We don't really know. But we know from the description of the Ahadith and the Quran, we know few traits or characteristics of that scale. Number one, that it's real. It is absolutely real because it will actually weigh things. That's number one. Number two, we know that it's used to weigh the deeds of people. It will weigh the deeds of people. Some of the ulama, they say it will weigh the actual person. Maybe there will be actually different ways of scaling things. Maybe Allah will scale the people, weigh the people. Allah subhanahu will weigh their deeds. Allah will weigh subhanahu wa ta'ala even just the cards, which means the final card that you get. You're not going to carry the entire book with you. The book is going to go into the archives, for example, and you only receive that card. That card is, even though it's digital format, but it has all what you need to give you the final result, how heavy this is going to be. So eventually, it will be used to scale the deeds of the people. It will be used to scale the books and the cards, and it could also be used to scale the actual individual. These scales are multiple. The ulama, they argue on what's the meaning of that. Is that just one scale, or does it mean that every human being has his own scale? It seems that everybody has his own scales. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَأَمَّا مَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُ. As for the one whose scales are heavy, means your scales are heavy. So it seems everybody has his own scales, you know, ready for him. So you have your deeds you placed over there. ثُمَّ قَالْ. And then ulama, they say also, that scale could be actually have, you know, two trays or two sides. On one side, they put the good deeds, on the other side goes the bad deeds. And then you see which one is heavier. Even the Prophet ﷺ said that تطيش الأعمال, which means it moves. So when you put the heavy, the deeds here and there, those trays, they act, you know, justly, of course, just like any other scale, to weigh accurately how much you owe. However, the system of justice with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is greater, of course, than here, because Allah azza wa jal, He always multiply the good deeds so they can outnumber the bad deeds. But with all of that, Allah musta'an, still some people, they're going to fail and they're going to have to stay behind to pay for that. Next, what deeds are the heaviest in the scale? What deeds are the heaviest in the scale? Of course, there are so many good deeds that are heavy in the scale. However, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned few for us that we know. Number one, saying La ilaha illallah. And Nabi ﷺ, he said that La ilaha illallah, al-tahuru shatr al-iman, walhamdulillahi tamla'u al-mizan, wa subhanallah walhamdulillah tamla'ani ma bayna al-sama'i wal-ard. He also said that saying Alhamdulillah, that also fills the scale. It fills the scale complete, which means it's going to be very heavy. So the first thing is saying, La ilaha illallah. Where do we get that from? We get that from the hadith, the very famous story the Prophet ﷺ mentioned. When a man, he almost dies, basically. When the man, he dies, and he comes resurrected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they check into his goodness, there is nothing there, except for one single card. This person, he came with one single card. What that card was? The card of La ilaha illallah. His sincerity to believe in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the only thing that he is left with as part of his good deeds. But then, when he said, okay, let's weigh this card. For him, he said, what is this card going to do against all these bad deeds that I have on the other side of the scale? When they put that card was so heavy that طاشت بها الصحاف, means the other side just was flying. How heavy La ilaha illallah is. What does that exactly mean? Means La ilaha illallah is indeed heavy. And the a'mal are by the quality, not just by the quantity. So if a person says La ilaha illallah sincerely from the heart, saying La ilaha illallah sincerely from the heart, and also saying La ilaha illallah, you know, with true belief, and also remorseful for the bad things that they do, even though they're doing bad deeds, but they're not so proud of themselves, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them. And Allah Azza will make this La ilaha illallah sufficient for them. There is no guarantee to anybody in particular though. But you're going to have hope inshallah wa ta'ala and have sincere belief in Allah Azza wa Jalla and the sincerity of La ilaha illallah. So that's the first one. The second one, good manners. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that there is nothing heavier in the scale on the Day of Judgment, أكتم الحسن الخلق. Good manners. See, many people are so busy acting religious. Many human beings, many people, they're very busy acting religious. What's the meaning of busy acting religious? Means they're busy into fasting Mondays and Thursdays, doing Qiyamul Layl, doing the Tasbih and the Adkar and so on. And all these are amazing good deeds. There is no doubt about it. They increase the scale, alhamdulillah, and will make it heavier, bidnillah azza wa jal. However, unfortunately, sometimes their good deeds don't go beyond the act itself. It means it becomes so mechanical that it loses its spiritual effect on them in terms of their akhlaq, their treatment with the people, and how they handle themselves, you know, in front of other people. So akhlaq, good manners, if you have the good manners, it's just a translation of the true faith. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Musa alayhi salam to Fir'aun, what did he say to him? In the entire message of Musa to Fir'aun was summarized in just few words. فَقُلْ هَلْ لَكَ إِلَىٰ أَنْ تَزَكَّى. You go and you tell him, shouldn't you purify yourself? And the meaning purify yourself means to have good akhlaq. And the first good akhlaq should be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worship number Allah azza wa jal, and then with other people afterwards. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was praised in the Quran, he was praised for what? For his akhlaq and his manners. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. That you are indeed on a high standard of character, Ya Muhammad. And even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he summarized in the entire message, praying the five daily prayers, fasting the month of Ramadan, giving charity, smiling in the face of other people, being helpful, doing all these good deeds. The Messenger of Allah, he summarized that by saying his message was all about what? إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِيُتَمِّمَ صَالِحَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. I was only sent to perfect the manners of people. The entire message of Islam was to perfect the manners of people in public and in private. So if you do that, if you get to that level, and if you behave with the people in good manners, regardless how they treat you, you treat them in good manners. You always use your standards when you treat the people. You don't use their standards. You don't say, well, they started it first. That's not someone who treats people in with good manners would ever say. Instead, whatever they do, you always treat people with good manners. It's one of the heaviest things you do, the heaviest things you bring to you to the Day of Judgment, your good manners. The third, subhanallah bihamdih, subhanallah al-azim. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, كَلِمَتَانِ خَفِيفَتَانِ عَلَى اللِّسَانِ. Two words are very light on the tongue. The way you pronounce them, they're very light. Subhanallah wa bihamdi. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ثَقِيلَتَانِ فِي الْمِيزَانِ. They'll be very heavy in the scale. Very heavy in the scale. حَبِيبَتَانِ إِلَى الرَّحْمَانِ. Most beloved to the most merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah wa bihamdi. Subhanallah al-azim. The word subhana means I free Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from any imperfection. That's what it means. At-tanzih. That you free Allah azza wa jal from any degree of imperfection, because he's the most perfect, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you say, Subhanallah wa bihamdi. Means I praise him, the one who is free from any imperfection. And I praise him, who the one who deserves all the praise, Subhanallah al-Azim, and he is the greatest, Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these words are very heavy in the scale. Keep repeating them as much as you can. Then finally, Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned that, in he said that La ilaha illallah, basically as we said in that scale, when that card will be added there, he said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, At-tahuru shatru al-iman, that is basically La ilaha illallah, wa-t-tahuru is the purification of the heart and the body. Walhamdulillah tamla'u al-mizan, and saying Alhamdulillah, I praise Allah azza wa jal, will fill the scale. It fills the scale. وَسُبْحَانَ وَالْحَمْدُ and سُبْحَانَ اللَّهُ تَمْلَآنِ مَا بَيْنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ will fill that which is between the heavens and the earth. Just four things that we have over here. If you can maintain that and work on this so hard, I hope inshallah ta'ala will suffice you bidnillahi azza for many, many things that you might, you know, don't have in time perhaps to do them. But maintain the good akhlaq and good manners and the dhikr and tasbih all the time inshallah ta'ala and being grateful to Allah azza wa jal. People now, they got the idea. They received their books. They came now to judge between each other, to resettle between each other. And eventually we have the description of that in many, many ways. As the Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned that the people would go to each other. They go to their brothers, their sisters, their mothers, their friends. Everybody now is trying to snatch and take as much as they can for themselves. And that's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's description, Surah Abasa, he says, يَوْمَ يَفِرُ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ. When everybody starts now flying away and fleeing away from his brother, وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ, his mother and his father, وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَأَخِيهِ, his wife and his children, everybody's running away from each other. No one is willing to help another right now. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that a man would be walking around asking for one single hasana, because when they scaled his deeds, the scale is now almost even and he needs one single merit to tip the scale. One single merit to tip the scale for himself. So he goes everywhere. Ya Fulan, don't you know me? Don't you remember me? I was your neighbor. I was a good neighbor to you. Can I have just one single hasana? I don't even know you now. My brother, my sister, my mom, my dad, no one would recognize you at that day. Nobody. Rasulullah ﷺ mentioned that even on that day, subhanAllah, generosity still exists though among the people. He said that this man would go to somebody else and he sees in his hand one single hasana. So he's standing in line perhaps. All he has is what? One single merit. So he comes to him. He goes, by the way, you only have one. And I need one just to pass. Can I get this? Because it doesn't seem to gonna benefit you at all. Means what is this going to do to you? Nothing. Can I have it? So the man eventually looking at the situation, he says, you know what? You're right. How much is it going to benefit me anyway? So he gives that hasana to this man. He says, take it. SubhanAllah, this man, of course, now, the one who received that hasana, for him, that's eternal bliss, Juma. Eternal bliss. He got it. So he goes to the scale, and the scale would go heavy, and that's it. He passed. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, who gave him this hasana? And Allah knows who gave him the hasana. And he said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that no one on this day, no one should be more generous than Allah azza wa jal. No one should be more generous than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for that Allah azza wa jal will order this man to grab the hand of the other person. He says, take him with you to Jannat al-Firdaus. Can you imagine? That hasana he thought is not going to benefit him, got him to al-Jannah subhanAllah. Now you say, but how could this happen? لا يسأل عما يفعل وهم يسألون. They cannot question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the most generous and he's the most just, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the justice there at that, at a different level, absolute different level. At that time when this person is now sacrificing himself to eternal, and عذاب and أليم and شديدة, a severe punishment, he sacrificed himself. But still Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know what, no one should be more generous than Allah azza wa jal. Take him with you to Jannat al-Firdaus. Now none of us should really even hope to be in that position, by the way. Don't say, this is really? So I can just be on the minimum, you know, so hopefully I can be in that position. Don't you even think like that. Because wallah, you don't even know if you're going to end up at that level. Then what happens next? People now, after they scaled everything, they have seen where they're going to be going. And now the disbelievers are taken away. The believers now are moving towards Jannah and towards Jahannam. Now, as they move towards Jannah and Jahannam, the believers, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test the munafiqeen, the hypocrites. In another station we didn't mention over here, it's al-dhulma. That's like a darkness. This is like a darkness that would lead towards al-Jannah and towards al-Sirat, the bridge over Jahannam. See, the people of Jahannam, or the people of the hypocrites, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not deal with them immediately. He leaves them to walk among the believers, thinking that they are actually benefiting from that and benefiting from their hypocrisy. So no one really paying attention to them, so that they're passing. With everywhere the believers go, they go with them. And now that the believers moving towards Al-Jannah, as they head towards paradise right now, they thought, okay, that's our turn right now, they're going to be heading towards Al-Jannah. But that's when they come to this darkness, as Allah described in Surah Al-Hadid, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's when the believers, they will be walking, يَسْعَى نُورُهُمْ بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَبِأَيْمَانِهِمْ. The believers are going to be provided with light by which they will be seeing through, and through this darkness. So the lights will be on their hands, in front of them, shining, depends on their good deeds. Some people, they have only light enough to light up their toes to see the next step only. But the hypocrites will be left without light. That's when they start calling upon the believers. Wait for us. Wait for us. Give us from the light that has been given to you. So just give us some light. So they will be told, irji'u wara'akum faltamisu nura. You go back, you can go and ask for light from there. So when they come back, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَضُرْبَ بَيْنَهُمْ بِسُورٍ. Allah Azza wa Jalla will command, will order that a barrier, a wall will be built between the believers who passed and the hypocrites who sat in the darkness. And that's when they realized that they've been deceived, like they were deceiving the believers in dunya. So when they were deceiving the believers, they thought, you know what, no one knows what we were doing, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهُ وَهُوَ خَادِعُهُمْ. They think they're tricking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but Allah will trick them on the Day of Judgment. And that is, of course, the greatest sorrow and grief for them. Because when you think you're passing, and no one is paying attention to your wrongdoing, and then suddenly you realize all of this was on purpose, to raise your hope so high, and then it's crushed. Now you realize it was all fake. It was all basically to trick you, just like you were tricking other people with that fake belief that you claimed you had back then. So as they were removed right now, the believers, they're heading right now towards Al-Sirat, and that's the bridge. For the Muslims, the Prophet ﷺ says the Ummah of Muhammad ﷺ will meet the Prophet ﷺ by the water pool or Al-Hawd. Al-Hawd, the Prophet ﷺ described Al-Hawd in many, many ahadith, how spacious, how great the size of the sama wal ard, bayna sama'i wal ard, and the cups, just like the number of stars, the water, if you drink from it, you will never feel thirsty after that, and the believers will be drinking from the hand of the Prophet ﷺ. So the Prophet gives so many descriptions. However, so sad that some of the believers, some of the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be banned from reaching to that water pool of that hawd. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as he was waiting for the people, they will be coming and rushing towards him. And as he recognized them because of the signs of the wudu, salawatullahi wasallam alayhi, the angels will come between him and these people and start steering some of the people away from him. And that's when he starts calling, Ya Rabbi, ummati, ummati, my people, where are you taking them? What's going on? He says, إِنَّكَ لَتَدْرِي مَا أَحْرَثُوا بَعْدَكَ. You don't know how much they've changed after you. You have no idea how much they've changed. It means they've changed your ways, they've changed your sunnah. They've just altered so many of the practices and with the innovations and bid'ah and so on. That's when the Prophet ﷺ, he would say, إِذَنْ سُحْقًا سُحْقًا, means they may be destroyed. So this Hibiyasi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he just kind of like giving up on them. If they did so they sacrificed that, so they deserve that the loss. And after the believers, they drink from the as-sirat. Now, with the other group right now that was steered away, they now gather together to go towards as-sirat. What is as-sirat? As-sirat is that bridge that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be built over Jahannam. And Allah azza wa jalla mentioned in Surah Maryam, قَالَ وَإِن مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا وَارِدُهَا كَانَ عَلَى رَبِّكَ حَتْمًا مَقْضِيًّا. That each and every one of you shall go over Jahannam. So even the believers, even the people of the Firdaus al-A'la, even the people of the Firdaus al-A'la, including the prophets and the messengers, they all shall pass over Jahannam. Why do you think they should pass over Jahannam? For what reason, Jahannam? To appreciate what Al-Jannah, right? When you see what's there, when you see what's there, you realize the greatest ni'mah of being in Al-Jannah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he described that as sirat in many, again, different ahadith. From this ahadith, he said, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, that it is going to be very thin. That it was adaqqu min al-sha'ra wa ahaddu min al-sayf. It's so thin, the thinner that than a hair, and it's also so sharper than the sword, the blade. It is also it's also going to be actually stretching all over Jahannam. And as people go over that, they will pass over Jahannam and over that bridge depending on their deeds, the speed that reflecting their good deeds. So some of the people will be running so fast, like the horse, like the wind, like the thunder, the lightning. Other they will just be just kind of like super fast eventually, so a different speed according to their deeds. And some people will be crawling. As the Prophet ﷺ described, one of the last people to arrive crossing the bridge, he will be actually crawling, and as he crawls, of course the heat will catch his shoulder and his legs. But still, at least he survives that. You might say, oh, I would love to be that person because of this I'm going to survive. Don't even try to think about it. Can you imagine the horror that he was going through as he was just trying to reach the other side? Knowing that other people, they will fall into Jahannam. The Prophet ﷺ described that bridge will have some sort of hooks. These hooks he described as a special plant in the Arabian Peninsula called As-Sa'dan, Kashawk As-Sa'dan. These are like thorns, like hooks. They stick to the person and they catch the person. So the Prophet ﷺ said, when people they're going through, فَنَاجٍ مُسَلَّمٍ. The people will fall into these categories. Number one, Najin Musallam. Someone who passes safely. Wanajin Makhdush. Someone who passes with bruises. Because as he tries to go, these hooks try to take him, try to hook him and throw him into Jahannam. So they will be kind of snatching, you know, part from their body, so they are injured. They're injured. But of course, this will be amended afterwards. This could be the last thing they deserved to be completely pure before they get into Al-Jannah. And then he says, وَمَكْدُوسٌ عَلَى رَأْسِ فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمِ. And other people will be snatched and will be thrown into Jahannam. Where were the believers? Where will be the Prophets salawatullah doing at this time? The Prophet says, as for the Anbiya and the Salihin, as they cross the bridge, what do? They start gathering there. SubhanAllah, they gather there. Now that's it. Once you cross the bridge, khalas, safety, it's over. So they cross there, and they start looking back at the bridge, looking at the people as they cross. And the Prophet ﷺ said, وَدُعَاءُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَالصَّالِحِينَ اللَّهُمَّ سَلِّمْ سَلِّمْ. All what the Anbiya and Salihin say that time, they're all saying, Ya Allah, give them safety. Ya Allah, give them safety. Allahumma sallim sallim. Allahumma sallim sallim. Ya Allah, give them safety. That's all the dua that the Anbiya and the Mursaleen and the Salihin will be saying on that moment. Then, once the last person crosses over that bridge, that's when people start looking around and trying to see. And now they start recognizing each other correctly. So when they look around, the people of Valley Ranch, inshallah, are going to start be looking at each other. I hope, inshallah, we're not going to miss anybody. But la qaddar Allah, some people will be looking around and then suddenly they will start thinking, you know, there's some people are missing. Where are they? And did you see Fulan? Did you see this person? Did you see that person? Did you see that lady? They don't see the people they used to hang out with in this dunya, from the good people. Then, so they start asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the shafa'at to ahli al-jannah. This is the shafa'at, the intercession of the people of Jannah. Ya Rabbana, ikhwanana, kan yusalluna ma'ana, wa yasumuna ma'ana, la narahum baynana. Oh Allah, these are our brothers, our sisters. They used to fast with us. They used to pray with us. We don't see them anymore. Look at this description, Jama'ah. They used to fast. They used to pray. So even though their salah, they were regular in their salah. They're regular in their fasting. But perhaps their manners were so bad. Their akhlaq, their attitude. Their manners with their wives. Their manners with their husbands. Their manners with their children. Their manners with their parents. So terrible. Their manners with their friends and their co-workers and their neighbors are so terrible that even their regular salah and their fasting could not save them from Jahannam. So the quality of your ibadah, the quality of your lifestyle is a reflection of how much you're benefiting from your ibadat. The quality of your life, it doesn't reflect spirituality, good manners and akhlaq. What's the point? What's the meaning of that? If your salah is not reminding you of standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if your fasting is not stopping you from doing the bad things against other people, if this is not helping you, that doesn't mean to quit the salah and your fasting, not at all. Instead, that means you need to ask Allah to help you benefit from it. You need to ask Allah to open your heart and clean your heart so you start benefiting from these ibadat. Otherwise, it's useless. You're just only doing a duty to Allah Azza wa Jal and you're not benefiting from it in this dunya. So these people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask them to go and look for them in Jahannam. So Allah Azza wa Jal will shield their bodies and they will go into Jahannam looking for these people that they're missing. And they start recognizing them, as the Prophet ﷺ says, by the traces of what? Al-wudu and al-salah. So they can tell that they're shining and these parts are being guarded and protected from being affected by the fire. So when they recognize them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command them to take out anyone that they can find with the amount of a golden dinar of iman, which means like saying a coin such as a quarter, for example. If you see in their hearts that the weight of a quarter of iman and faith, get them out. So they get out as many as they can. And then they say, Ya Rab, we got them all. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay, go back again and look for the people that you can find the weight of smaller, like a nickel, for example, of iman, and get them out. So they get them out. And then it keeps going down until matqala khardal, even if it was just the seed of mustard seed of iman, just get them out. Even then it goes to dharra, the speck of dust of faith and iman. Get them out. So they get them out. And then finally, when they leave the last person out, they take the last person out, they would say, Ya Rabbana, lam yabqa fiha illa man habasahu al-Qur'an. No one is left behind over there except from whom they've been detained by the Qur'an. And what do they mean by this? They mean by the ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, qala Allah ta'ala, inna Allah la yaghfiru an yushraka bihi, وَيَغْفُرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ. He would never forgive. As Surah Nisa, actually, he would never forgive those who commit shirk. But he forgives anything less than that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive anything less than that, but not shirk. That means those who've been detained in Jahannam, may Allah protect us all from that, are those who come with a sin such as the major sin, which is worshipping other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then, once they're all out, that's when they head towards Al-Jannah, and people of Jahannam, they stay in Jahannam. What happens in Al-Jannah? How does it look like? How will they enter Al-Jannah? Who is the first person to enter? The last person to enter? What description of Jannah? How does it look like there? And Jahannam, the same thing. How does it look like? The adab, all these things, how they look like? Will be our discussion, inshallah wa ta'ala, when we come back after Ramadan. So with that, we come to an end of the series, inshallah ta'ala, this evening. We're going to take a break, inshallah, before Ramadan, just in preparation for the month of Ramadan. Get yourself busy, inshallah, in Sha'ban, by fasting, doing a lot of good deeds. The son of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Sha'ban, according to Aisha, radiallahu ta'ala anha, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, أو ما أتم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صيام شهر إلا رمضان. The Prophet never completed fasting an entire month, completely, other than Ramadan. However, in Sha'ban, he used to fast hatta naqul la yuftar. He used to fast until we say he's not going to break his fast at all. And then sometimes he starts Sha'ban, he would fast no days whatsoever until we think that he's not fasting anything this year. So eventually, fast as many days as you can from Sha'ban, inshallah ta'ala. It's starting very soon. Maybe in these couple of days, inshallah ta'ala, Sha'ban will be in and that will be it. It means the countdown to Ramadan starts, inshallah. Get ready. If you plan to memorize certain surahs in Ramadan, why don't you start in Sha'ban? If you plan to do khatma in Ramadan, inshallah, get adjusted. Warm up in Sha'ban. See how you can fit that in your schedule, in your busy schedule. If you plan to come frequently for Fajr, for Isha, then do it in Sha'ban. Get yourself adjusted, inshallah, in Sha'ban. Hopefully, inshallah, by the time Ramadan comes, you already warmed up for it, alhamdulillah, and you've already gained and built momentum. So you don't have to wait until the last 10 days to benefit from Ramadan. No, you already can benefit from the first night of the month of Ramadan, inshallah ta'ala. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to give us the ability and make our life long enough to attempt this month of Ramadan. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who will be able to fast this month of Ramadan. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who will witness Laylatul Qadr in Ramadan. And we ask Allah azza to make us among those who will be forgiven all their sins in this month of Ramadan. Walhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Any question, Juma? Come on. Say it again. Yeah, we went through a lot of events, a lot of stations in the last day. So when the Hisab one-on-one will take place? That was actually discussed two weeks ago. We discussed that, different Hisabs. Some people will be alone, and everybody will be alone, as a matter of fact. But some people will be questioned, and the meaning of being questioned, that means they will be asked to give an answer. And others, they will only be reminded with what they've done. If a person was reminded only, it's great. That means, alhamdulillah, they are safe. Allah will forgive them. But if Allah Azza wa Jal asks them a question that requires an answer, then they're doomed. That's the problem. Wallahu ta'ala. That's way before that. All these events come after the Hisab. We're done with the Hisab, and then all these events come after the Hisab. Nah. Wallahu
a'lam. So, you mentioned the jinn. Did you say that you were going to have the Hisab the same way the animals
did? No. The jinn will have the Hisab like the humans. But the animals are the only creatures that Allah subhanahu will bring them only to show us how, to what level justice is going to be. Even among those creatures who are not even accountable, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them justice. So the deer will take a revenge from the bear, and this animal will take a revenge from this, and so on, eventually just to give them justice. Wallaha. Yes? Yes. Well, like we said, when you receive your book in your right hand, you know that you're gonna win eventually, right? So you pass. But what is the GPA right now? What is the grade still? Even though you've been given primary right now, you know, good news that you're passing. However, you're going to have to, first of all, go through a settlement. And then after that, the settlement is going to now bring people to start having an anxiety. How much is left of my good deeds right now? But you know that you're passed. But then, if they do not pass completely, meaning, are they going to be punished in Jahannam? Are they going to be just scratched? Are they going to be just, you know, being scorched? Or are they going to fall into Jahannam? May Allah protect us from that. So all of this will still have some level of anxiety until they cross the bridge. Once you cross the bridge, that's when you know you're done, you're going straight to Al-Jannah. Wallahu ta'ala. Now, anyway, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, he said, and who is speaking, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, like we were talking about him a few nights ago, he is the first wali of awliya Allah al-Salihin among the ummah, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu warda. Still though, he would say, if I have my right foot in Jannah and my left foot is still outside al-Jannah, I wouldn't be sure until I have them both in there. Which means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Adl al-Hakam. He is the one who does the way he wants, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, once I get in there, that's when I guarantee, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised that if you enter al-Jannah, what type of life are you getting there? The jama'ah in al-Jannah, what type of life? Khalidina fiha abada. Eternal life. Allah promised, if you get into al-Jannah, that's it. There'll be no feeling of grief or fear whatsoever. So that's why if the both feet, he said, if both my legs are in there, khalas, I guarantee it now. So that's Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Imagine us, how should we, you know, look at ourselves on that day. Allah. Yes. A question, is La ilaha illallah sufficient on Judgment Day? Well, La ilaha illallah, that's for all the nations, right? But each nation has its own prophet and messenger. So for us, it's La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And besides, I mean, if you say La ilaha illallah sincerely, that entails what? That you also believe that the Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. And if someone did not believe that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, La ilaha illallah in this case, it had been abrogated already. You deny Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's messenger, you're denying Allah azza wa jalla. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَن يُطِعَ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهَ. that if you obey the messenger, then you obey Allah Azza wa Jalla. And if you don't obey the messenger, you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahu a'lam. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so sometimes, let's say, if we're going to be settling some of those rights and those dues that we owe other people, sometimes we did that in the past when we were younger and we were very reckless and heedless and all the stuff and so on. So now that we're recovering and waking up from that past, how am I going to go after these people to pay them back? I remember I heard this brother. I remember saying this bad word to this brother. I know that this sister, I took from her this thing, I never brought it back to her. So you know all these things, but you can have no access to these people. What do you do in this case? If you cannot have access to them to seek forgiveness from them, then at least you make dua for them. You ask Allah to forgive you, repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make dua for them, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive them. That's one thing. Second, if this is huququn maddiya, which means financial rights, if you still have that thing in your hand and you have no access to this individual that you know it's his or hers, in this case, you give it in charity. And if that person at one point in life, you met them and you told them, by the way, one day I took this from you, but I gave it in charity. If you want, you can keep that charity for yourself. If not, I'll give you the amount and inshallah, I'll take the reward for that charity. So eventually try your best. But at least the least thing you could do is ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask Allah Azza's help to, you know, forgive you and reconcile between these people on Judgment Day. Wallahu a'lam. Now, yes. So when people go over the bridge, are they going to all do the shafa'ah or some group from those people? The hadith doesn't say that there's a group of people that will be given honor the shafa'ah. It seems that the people of Al-Jannah, means all of those who passed, then now have the right, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the permission of Allah azza wa jal, to intercede for these people who were thrown in Jahannam. Wallahu ta'ala. Now. Yes. Anyone who practices shirk is not forgiven that sin. That's what Allah says. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ. He will never forgive those associate partners with him. Anyone who associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worship, this is not going to be forgiven. Meaning if they know consciously that they're associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they've been educated or told or even discussed with about the meaning of worshipping one God and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they insisted in worshipping their idols or they're worshipping their own deities that are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as partners, this sin is not forgiven. Wallahu ta'ala. Yes. Of course, if someone committed shirk in the past and then they forgive, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rahim. Allah will forgive them the sin, of course. But we're talking about someone who dies on a state of shirk. Someone who dies on a state of shirk. And this is, in basically, since we're talking about this issue, this is not just non-believers, by the way. This is not just among the non-Muslims. Unfortunately, some Muslims, they fell into the shirk in many, many different ways. You know, some people, they fell into shirk that they go to worship around certain graves. And they do believe in the superpower of these graves. They call them shrines. They claim these are shrines of the awliya. You know, let it be. Let it be that this person is a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let it be this person one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no doubt that they're honorable. Their status is so high in the Muslim ummah. But that doesn't mean by any standard, that does not mean you go and seek help and assistance from them. You only seek help and assistance from whom? From the one who created them. But many people in the Muslim ummah, they invented these shrines. And now they're just kind of like worshipping them. Almost every single Muslim country, almost, you'll find some certain group of, you know, people who always value these shrines. When someone dies, they build a huge masjid on top of it, and then eventually they start calling people to come and make their ibadah, pay their dues over there. It just, Allah musta'an, becomes like a business, unfortunately. So that is a form of shirk that the Muslim ummah is falling into. Wallahu musta'an. So inshallah ta'ala, when we come back after Ramadan bin Allah Azza wa Jal, we will be discussing Al-Jannah and Jahannam. May Allah protect us from Jahannam, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from among the people of Al-Jannah. Wallahu ta'ala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
البحر مدادا لكلمات ربي لنا